Okay, so you're given a function f of x, a center x is equal to a. From that function, you are writing the Taylor series. So in the last lecture, we were addressing this question that for what values of x, the Taylor series is convergent to f of x. Fine. And then we had the answer for this thing that you have, you can write f of x is equal to pnx plus rnx, where this pnx is, what is this? This is Taylor polynomial. Polynomial of order n, and this is remainder after n terms. This is called Taylor formula. So Taylor formula says that although you cannot write f of x is equal to the Taylor series, it means that Taylor series may not be convergent, and if it is convergent, it may not, the sum may not be equal to f of x. But you can for sure write f of x is equal to pnx plus rnx, where your rnx is, where rnx was, can you tell me what was the formula for rnx? It was n plus 1th derivative at c into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial, where c is a number between x and a. Clear hai sabko beta ye cheez? And then we saw this thing that if for all those values of x for which Rn goes to 0 as n goes to infinity, in that case, you see what will happen. F of x will be equal to the Taylor series sum n from 0 to infinity f n x upon n factorial x minus a raised to power n. Is that okay? Because as n goes to infinity, this is 0, you are saying, and this will be equal to the the Taylor series. So this is the result which we had discussed in the last lecture, that for all those values of x for which Rn goes to 0 as n goes to infinity, that for those values of x, your Taylor series will be convergent and the sum will be equal to the generating function, the original function. Okay, so we'll do examples. Last time we have done the example of e raised to power x. So now let us write this sin x. Okay, so question is, show that the Maclaurin series, you see there is no difference between Maclaurin and Taylor, the only difference is the center is 0. For sin of x converges to sin x for all x. Okay, so let us see this thing. So we are saying that Maclaurin series for sin x converges to sin x for all x. So let us see what is the Maclaurin series of sin x. You already know how to write this. So sin x, for sin x, you'll write the Maclaurin series is f nth derivative at 0 upon n factorial x minus 0 raised to power n, n from 0 to infinity. So this is the required Maclaurin series. And we know that what is this series? You already have computed this. You have computed the derivatives. You have f of x is equal to sin x. So first derivative is cos x. Second derivative is minus sin x. Fourth derivative is minus cos x, and so on. So we have seen that when you compute at x is equal to 0, you'll get f of 0 is 0. F of f dash 0 is 1. F double dash 0 is 0. F triple dash, F triple dash 0 is minus 1, and so on. Okay, so from here you can see that the even derivative is 0 and odd derivative is equal to minus 1 is power k. Clear? Because the first derivative is positive, third derivative is negative, and so on. Clear? So we get that even derivative is 0, odd derivative is minus 1 raised to power k. Therefore, Maclaurin series is x x minus x cube upon 3 factorial plus x5 upon 5 factorial minus x7 upon 7 factorial and so on. So the general term is minus 1 raised to power k x raised to power 2k plus 1 upon 2k plus 1 factorial. Is that thing clear to everybody? And after that you have a remainder which you will call as r2k plus 1x. So this is the remainder after 2k plus 1 terms. So do you understand why I'm writing 2k plus 1 instead of n? Because for all the even terms are 0. So that is why I will have only odd terms. So that is why I'm writing 2k plus 1 for the odd number. So this is the Maclaurin series. Okay. Sorry, I should not write like this. I should write like this. This is the Maclaurin series. And from Taylor's formula, sine x is equal to these terms, x minus x cube upon 3 factorial plus x raised to power 5 upon 5 factorial minus x raised to power 7 upon 7 factorial plus minus 1 raised to power k x raised to power 2k plus 1 upon 2k plus 1 factorial plus remainder after 2k plus 1 terms. Is that thing clear? Okay, now we want to see for what value of x the series converges to sine x. So you have to see for what values of x r2k plus 1x goes to 0. Now let us see what is r2k plus 1x. Can you tell me? Tell me, Mita, what is this? Tell me, Mita, what is the formula of rnx?
F derivative of n plus 1.
Yeah.
So here in this case, 2k plus 2. 2k plus 2. 2k
plus 2 derivative at which point?
C.
0.
C. Not at 0.
C.
At C. Into x raised to power 2k plus 2 upon 2k plus 2 factorial, where C is between 0 and x. Clear? Right? Now here, what is this term? What is this term? Tell me, Mita. This will be either sine or cos. Okay. So f2k plus 2 at c mod is for sure less than 1. Ye clear hai sabko? Because this is either sine or cos. So you see, you don't have any information about c. So somehow you have to eliminate this c. So here, because this derivative is either sine c or cos c with a negative positive sign. So for sure, whatever it is, the mod is less than equal to 1. Clear hai ye cheez sabko?
Yes, ma'am.
So from here, what you see that if you take the mod r2k plus 1x mod is equal to mod of f2k plus 2 at c into mod x raised to power 2k plus 2 divided by 2k plus 2 factorial. Now this is less than equal to, because this is less than equal to 1, 1 into mod x raised to power 2k plus 2 upon 2k plus 2 factorial. Now what is the limit? What is the limit here? This goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. Clear enough? Because limit n going to infinity x raised to power n upon n factorial was 0. So this limit here is 0. Therefore, r2k plus 1 x goes to 0 as k goes to infinity for all x. You know, irrespective of the value of x, this is always 0. Therefore, sine x is always equal to x minus x cube upon 3 factorial plus x5 upon 5 factorial minus x7 upon 7 factorial and so on for all values of x. Clear, beta? So this series is valid for all values of x.
Ma'am, please wait your last step to note.
Okay, beta. So you see, ye dekhiye, dobara yahan se nahi samajh mein aaya hoga na? That, okay, from here, please, okay. So from here, we have this remainder after 2k plus 1 terms. So do you understand that how I'm writing this? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
We have this formula that rnx is n plus 1th derivative at c into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. So here I am writing, because it is 2k plus 1 here, So I'm writing 2k plus 2 at c into x raised to power 2k plus 2 upon 2k plus 2 factorial. Now I want to know what is the limit here. You know? That is the only thing I have to do. So for that, because I don't know c exactly what c is, so I'm trying to eliminate this part. So now I know that this is the 2k plus 2th derivative of sine. So that will be either sine c or cos c. Whatever it is, I know that the value will be less than or equal to 1. Okay, so mod value will be less than or equal to 1. So that is why I have taken mod here. So when you take mod here, now this number is less than or equal to 1. Okay, so I'm writing this less than or equal to 1 into this number. Now I know that this number goes to 0 as k goes to infinity, because I have x raised to power n upon n factorial is 0 as n goes to infinity. Okay, so this number is 0. So it means that this mod is less than or equal to 0. So it means that this is 0 number, because mod of something less than or equal to 0, it means that that number is 0, because mod is always positive. So this limit is 0 for all values of x. It means that sine x is equal to this series for all values of x. Is that thing clear?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, beta.
Ma'am, हमने जब हम sin x की Taylor series लिख रहे थे तो हमने सारे even terms इसलिए सारे even terms से मेरा मतलब है सारे even derivatives को सिर्फ इसलिए करा था क्योंकि वो zero हो जाते हैं, है ना?
Yes, yes.
ma'am, तो अब हम लोग जो r 2k plus 1th लिख रहे हैं तो उसमें f 2k plus 2 लिख रहे हैं तो ये भी तो even हो गया.
But
तो
that is 0 at 0.
वो सिर्फ 0, x
is 0. That is 0 at 0. Here, this is c.
हाँ हाँ, ठीक है ma'am, समझ गया. Thank you.
Okay, beta. So let us do now. You see, in the last two problems, e raised to power x and sine x. Okay, in both the problems, you must have seen that n plus 1th derivative at c was bounded. So we have just written that this number is less than is equal to some number. Okay, so we have this result. If you observe that in both these cases, here it was less than equal to 1. And in case of fn plus 1c, in case of e raised to power x, you can go back to your question and you can see that we had written that it was less than equal to 1 or less than is equal to e raised to power x. Do you remember? Okay. So we have this result that if Rn x is less than equal to m, okay, into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. So what will happen? If this is the true, this is true, then because this limit is 0, this is a number. So in that case, you will get that Maclaurin series or Taylor series converges to f of x. Is that thing clear? Because this limit is 0. Or this will happen if f n plus 1th derivative at c is less than or equal to m, because this term, your Rnx is n plus 1th derivative at c into this term. So if n plus 1th derivative at c is less than or equal to m, so your Rnx is less than or equal to m into this quantity, and this quantity goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So you'll get Rnx goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So your Taylor series converges to f of x. So this is, if you have this condition, you just check this condition, then you can straight away write that your Taylor series converges to f of x. Is that thing clear? Let me repeat. I'm saying that your Rnx is fn plus 1th derivative at c into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. If I take mod, so I will get mod of Rnx is equal to mod of fn plus 1th derivative at c into mod of x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. And if this number, this quantity here is less than or equal to m, right, then you will get that Rnx goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So you can just test this thing. You can just test this thing. Just a minute, beta. Okay, so is that thing clear to everybody? That if you
can you repeat what is m here? A constant or
m is any number, is any constant. For example, yeah. In the last case, we get that here this m is 1. Okay, here also in this case, we get m equal to 1 or e raised to power x. X is a fixed number, so e raised to power x is your m. Okay, is that thing clear? In the last case, you see. Here you get sine x is bounded by, the derivative is bounded by 1. So that is your m. So all I'm saying is whenever your n plus 1th derivative is bounded, then you can just write that this will converge. Or you if you don't want to use this, that is also okay. But I'm just telling you that if this number is bounded, this quantity here is bounded, then you know that your rnx will go to 0 as n goes to infinity. Okay?
Ma'am, can you scroll up a little, please?
Yeah, sure, beta.
A little more.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So let us do for the same thing or I will write it here. For example, here, this is case one. Just note it. Second note is, if your Rnx, which is n plus 1th derivative at C, into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. Now you see, you have, if your n plus 1th derivative is less than is equal to m into r raised to power n plus 1. Okay? In that case, what will happen? Your rnx will be less than is equal to m r raised to power n plus 1 x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. Right? Now you see, what is this? This is m r x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial, right? And this quantity here goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Therefore, r n x goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Okay, so here you can look at this example. For example, if I'm looking at this function f of x is equal to 2 cos 3x. Fine? Or you can just take, okay. So in this case, can you tell me what is m and what is r? In this case, can you tell me what is m and what is r?
M is 2.
Yeah, m is 2 because 2 is here. What is r? Because every time you derivative, you take a derivative, there will be a factor of 3. So it means that if you are at n plus 1th derivative, there will be a factor of 3. So there m is 2. Yes, beta.
Ma'am, what is here m into small r power n plus 1?
Yeah, that is what I'm telling you, beta. I'm saying, suppose your function is of this form. That function is less than is equal to m into r raised to power n plus 1. Where r is any number. I'm taking you an example. M and r are constants. Okay? So I'm giving you an example that if you look at here, f of x is 2 into cos 3x. So what will be f dash x? That will be 2 into minus 3 sine 3x. What will be f double dash x? That will be minus 2 3 square cos 3x. Can you see? What will be f triple dash x? That will be minus 2 plus 2 3 cube sine 3x. So you see, everything is bounded by 2 into 3. Here, 2 into 3 squared, 2 into 3 cube. So it means that n plus 1th derivative at C is less than is equal to 2 into 3 raised to power n plus 1. So this is your m and this is your r. Clear, beta? Is that thing clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So obviously, you are not...
M or R wala, ek bar ma'am, is question ko ma'am.
Sure, beta, sure. You see, I'm saying that whenever you have a function whose n plus 1th derivative at C is n plus 1th derivative at C is less than is equal to m into R raised to power n plus 1. If you have a function like this, then for sure, R and X will go to 0 as X goes to infinity for all X. Okay, why? Because you will have r and x less than is equal to m r raised to power n plus 1 x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. And this you can write as r into x minus a raised to power n plus 1 upon n plus 1 factorial. And this number goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Now I am giving you an example here that f of x is equal to 2 into cos 3x. So if you take f dash x, you will get minus 2 into 3 sine 3x. F double dash x will be minus 2 into 3 square into cos 3x. F triple dash will be 2 into 3 cube into sine 3x and so on. So here you can see that your f dash x is bounded by 2 into 3 f double dash because its maximum value is 1. F double dash is bounded by 2 into 3 square. F triple dash is bounded by 2 into 3 cube and so on. So it means that n plus 1th derivative is bounded by m into r raised to power n plus 1.
Ma'am?
Yes, but
thank you, ma'am.
मैम यहाँ पे स्मॉल r 3 कैसे हुआ
बेटा देखो ना 3 इज कमिंग अगेन एंड अगेन सो यू सी ओके आई एम सेइंग m into r raised to power n plus 1 यू सी दिस इज फिक्स्ड एवरी टाइम यू डेरिवेटिव यू टेक द डेरिवेटिव यू गेट अ 3 फैक्टर ऑफ 3 मोर सो दैट इज व्हाई 3 इज इंक्रीजिंग दैट इज व्हाई r इज 3 क्लियर
यस मैम
ओके बेटा
मैम
यस बेटा मॉड आर एन एक्स इंस्टेड ऑफ आर एन राइट सो द आंसर इज आई वांट टू सी For what values of x, r and x goes to 0, right? Now, if I just see for what values of x, r and x mod goes to 0, because this is a number which is positive. So, if it is going to 0, it means that this quantity is also going to 0. That is why I'm taking mod. Okay? And also, because with mod, I am able to see what is the value of this quantity. Because I don't know exactly what C is, but I know that C is a number between 0 and X. And that information I'm using. And with that information, I'm just getting a bound on Fn plus 1C. Is that okay? Okay, but if you practice, you will get to understand more. So let me move ahead. There is something called, in the tutorial sheet, you must have seen that in some questions, for example, there was a question of X into log X. Do you remember? Have you seen the question in the tutorial sheet, x into log x? Yes, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So, if you... Okay, so suppose you have a function like x into sine x, say. X into sine x. And I ask you, write its Maclaurin series. So, can you tell me how you will write it? Maclaurin series, you know that Maclaurin series nth derivative at 0 x raised to power n upon n factorial n from 0 to infinity. So you know this is your Maclaurin series. So your f of x is equal to x into sine x. What will be f dash x? Tell me. That will be
x cos x plus sine x.
What will be f double dash x?
Minus x sine x plus
minus x sine x plus cos x. So that will be 2 cos x minus x sine x. So you can do this, but this is little bit difficult. Okay? Derivatives, little bit difficult. For example, if you have something else here, like 2, or you have log x, so derivatives may be little difficult. So can you think of anything else? If without this approach?
Simply differentiating.
Ma'am,
sine x.
Maclaurin series for sine x and you multiply it with x. Okay, so what you can do is you can write for writing Maclaurin series of x sine x, you can write the Maclaurin series of sine x and then you can multiply it with x. You can multiply it with x. again you will get a Maclaurin series, right? For example, here what we are going to do, we already know how to write the Maclaurin series of sine x, or you can write in the exam minus x cube upon x 3 factorial plus x raised to power 5 upon 5 factorial minus x raised to power 7 upon 7 factorial and so on. And this is true for all values of x, for all x. We have already seen that you can write sine x is equal to this. So you can write x sine x is equal to this for all x. Okay, so this is x square minus x4 upon 3 factorial plus x6 upon 5 factorial minus x8 upon 7 factorial and so on. So this is the required Maclaurin series. This is called Maclaurin series by multiplication. So this method is called finding Maclaurin series by multiplication. Is that okay, beta? So this is your choice. You can do by this
again. Ma'am, why did we multiply with x?
Because the question is write the Maclaurin series for x sine x.
Okay? But ma'am, the x is not constant.
Yeah, it is not a constant, but what is a Maclaurin series? Maclaurin series is a series where you have powers of x. So what I'm doing here is I'm just writing the Maclaurin series of sine x. Okay, then I'm multiplying with x. Okay, but for example, if you have this question that write a Maclaurin series of sine x into say e raised power x. In that case, I cannot do like this. Okay, suppose instead of e raised power x, you have something like log of x. In that case, I cannot do that. I write the Maclaurin series for sine x and multiply with log x, because that is not a Maclaurin series. Is that okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, because multiplication x raised to power something will not change the nature of Maclaurin series. So that is why you can just write the Maclaurin series of sine x and then you do the multiplication. Yes, beta?
Memo, please x sine x ka jo Maclaurin series hai wo bhi formula se karna ek baar formula.
Okay, beta, please ask your questions. Try to ask your questions in English if possible, because there are some students who are having problem. Okay, beta, okay, you can do this with this also. You just find out. You try to find out. Approach that. What will the general value of and its derivative. So you have f of x is equal to x sine x. So f dash x is, you have sine x plus x cos x. Fine. F double dash x. Can you try what will be the general form if you are getting anything? You will get anything for sure. So this is cos x plus cos x minus x sine x. So this is 2 cos x minus x sine x. And then you have f triple dash x. That will be minus 2 sine x minus sine x. Okay. And then you will have minus x cos x. Fine. So this is minus 3 sine x minus x cos x. Then you go for fourth derivative. That will be minus 3 cos x. Okay. Minus 3 cos x. Yes, beta.
Ma'am, iska koi general term nahi aa raha, like har term abhi har bar iska alternate.
Yeah, something.
Yes, ma'am. Mera bhi same question hai, ma'am.
Yeah, that is why I'm telling you, because sometimes finding the general term is difficult. That is why I'm telling you an alternative that you can go for the for writing the Taylor series of this function and then you just multiply. That is why I'm telling you. Okay, beta.
Ma'am, because yeah, it actually takes a lot of time. Na, ki hum usko sara kare, fir uske baad sara kuch hoga.
Yes, beta, that's what I'm saying, that the moment you see such problems, you can just write the Taylor series for sine x and you multiply. Because here it will take time. That is what I have written here. Little difficult. Okay? But it is not undoable, but difficult. Calculations will be more. Okay, so whosoever was saying that, ma'am, please do it. You can try writing the term, beta. Okay? Yes, beta?
Ma'am, why can't we do this for ln x and only for x?
Because that, if you have ln x into sine x, okay, and I'm just writing here x minus x cube upon 3 factorial plus x5 upon 5 factorial, x7 upon 7 factorial, and then I multiply, then that is no longer
we do have,
right? Because in Maclaurin series, you should be having this form, some constant into x minus 0 raised to power n upon n factorial. So if there is ln x, then this is not of this form. No? That is why, in that case, you have to do something else. Maybe write this also. And then
ma'am, we have.
No, ma'am, because actually ln 0 is not defined.
Sorry, beta?
Ma'am, because actually ln 0 is not defined, so we are not doing that.
Ln plus 1. Okay, that I can take. Is that okay? okay, fine. So, but still, you cannot write the Maclaurin series because if you multiply like this, you cannot write because if you multiply
ma'am, x have... log,
yes,
ma'am. To no, ma'am, we do possess the series of but a Taylor for ln x plus one.
Exactly.
You see here, if you're writing the Maclaurin series here, and then you multiply with log x plus one, that is no longer a Maclaurin series because Maclaurin series should be of this form. There should be only the powers of x, no other function. Here you have log of x plus one. Either you write the Maclaurin series of this also and then do the multiplication. But that because you have in two infinite series, multiplication is also not possible.
Ma'am, okay. So we can't introduce the factor on a Taylor series, na?
No, you can write with the usual method. Okay, this is the usual method that is always working. Okay, even if it is little difficult, but it will always work. Okay, so the next is Maclaurin series or Taylor series by substitution. Substitution. For example, if you have write the Maclaurin series for cos of 2x, right? So here either you can write with the usual method or we already know that cos of x is 1 minus x square upon 2 factorial plus x4 upon 4 factorial minus x6 upon 6 factorial and so on. So cos of 2x just replace with 2x. You replace x with 2x. This is for all x. So if you want to write the Maclaurin series for cos 2x, replace x with 2x. Okay? Because this is valid for all x. So you have 1 minus 2 square x square upon 2 factorial plus 2 4 x raised to 4 upon 4 factorial minus 2 6 up into x 6 upon 6 factorial and so on. So this is the Maclaurin series of cos 2x. So this is called Maclaurin series by substitution. So these things you can use in the tutorial sheets or in the problem solving. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So we are left with the last part. Okay. So last part is. Yes, beta. Anybody having any doubt till here? Because this is the last part for this chapter. Then we will move on to the next chapter. So you see, do you remember? I will not start this today, but I'll just give you a little introduction. Do you remember when we were writing or studying alternating series? So I have told you error estimation theorem. Everybody remembers that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we will revisit that part. So I'm saying here, you have f of x, some function is equal to a Taylor series. Suppose your Taylor series is convergent to your function. So you have a Taylor series and that is equal to, the sum is equal to the original function. Now, this is a sum of infinite terms. This is a sum of infinite terms and we cannot add infinite terms, right? Even with the help of supercomputers, right? You cannot add infinite terms. Can you tell me why? Why we cannot add infinite terms? Anybody? Why we can't add infinite terms?
Because we are not able to get an absolute sum after adding the infinite sum.
Exactly.
We cannot add infinite terms because adding infinite terms will take infinite time. Because infinite terms means jo kabhi khatam na ho. So if you are
adding, we are not getting any inappropriate result.
But please let me complete. I'm saying that you cannot add infinite terms because infinite terms will take infinite time to add. Because there are infinite terms means they will never end. It means if you have added, say, 10 is power 10 term, then still there is a next term. And whatever number you add, you still have a next term. So we cannot add infinite terms because there are, they will, adding infinite terms will take infinite time. It means it will take forever. So we will never get a result. So what we are saying here is then what is the use of writing this series if we cannot add infinite terms? So what we say that what you can do, you can write, you can just take the first two terms. Say you are taking the first two terms, right? F, FA, that will be the zeroth derivative plus F dash A into X minus A upon 1 factorial. So I can approximate my F of X with this. Okay? Or you can take more terms, FA into F dash A, X minus A upon 1 factorial plus F double dash A upon into X minus A square upon 2 factorial. I can approximate my F of X with these. Or I can take four terms. So I can approximate F of X with F of A plus F dash A into X minus A plus F double dash A upon 2 factorial X minus A square plus F triple dash A upon 3 factorial into X minus A cube. So what you can do, you can approximate. This is a symbol for approximation. Is that okay? Now, yes, if you are approximating, here will be some error. Because if you are approximating f of x is equal to this, with this, there will be some error. And here also some error is there. Here also some error is there. Is that okay? So the next question is, if we approximate f of x with some terms of Taylor series, what is the error introduced? Question is clear to everybody? That you have an infinite series equal to f of x, and since we cannot add infinite terms, so we will approximate some the sum with some terms, like say n terms. Here I'm just taking two terms, here I'm taking three terms, here I'm taking four terms. So I would like to know that if I'm taking two terms and then I'm taking three terms and then I'm taking four terms, so how much error I am introducing? Is that okay? So that is your next question which you will answer. So already we have done this thing for alternating series where we have seen that if we are approximating, do you remember? If we are approximating an alternating series, it was a1 minus a2 plus a3 minus a4 and so on, plus minus 1 raised to power n plus 1 an. Okay? With n terms. Okay? The sum you were approximating, the exact sum was L and this is Sn. So what was L minus Sn? Do you remember? This was less than is equal to the first discarded term, n plus 1 is term mod. And sine of L minus Sn was minus 1 raised to power n plus 2. Is that thing clear? So we have already seen this thing in alternating series where we were saying that if you have an alternating series and you are having the exact sum as L and n is the sum of the first n numbers, then L minus Sn was less than is equal to the mod of first discarded term. So this result we have already seen, but in tomorrow's class we will answer this question for general Taylor series, what is the error introduced? Is that thing clear? Okay, beta. So tomorrow we will be doing this part.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay,
ma'am. Ma'am, sine क्या होता है? ma'am, sine क्या होता है? L minus Sn का?
Sine means if positive, is it positive or negative?
नहीं ma'am, तो वो कैसे हम लोग लाइक पता लगाएंगे लाइक?
So that sine is the, what is the sine of the next term? The next term we know that the sine is minus 1 raised to power n plus 2. So whatever is the sine of the next term, that is the sine of L minus Sn.
Okay, ma'am.
That was the theorem in alternating series. We have already done this part. But tomorrow, we'll be answering this question that how much error is introduced when you are approximating f of x with few terms of Taylor series. Not all, few terms of Taylor series. Okay, okay then. Thank you, everybody.
Have thank a nice you, ma'am.
I will see you tomorrow.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.